Şimdi ben sahneye Shopify'dan Ricardo Vasquez'i davet etmek istiyorum.
Hello
Hi
everyone.
Ricardo.
Hi, how are you?
Fine. You too. How are you?
Great, great. Doing great.
Okay. Are you in Canada?
Yes, I'm very close to Toronto, about 45 minutes away from Toronto, one of our biggest cities.
Okay. Have you ever been in Istanbul or Turkey?
No, I've always wanted to. I've always wanted to. In a way, I'm there right now, but after this is all over, I will definitely go. The organizers and I, we already have a good Turkish coffee planned when I can
Okay.
actually go back and visit.
I hope we organize it offline next year, and maybe you will be our keynote speaker. And here is your stage.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
hi everyone. My name is Ricardo. I am a manager at a company called Shopify. We are an e-commerce company. I'm actually not going to be talking about Shopify at all. I'm not going to be talking about design at all. I'm going to be talking about stories and stories that bring us a new level of knowledge and how we can harness that knowledge and apply it to our work. In this room and in this live stream, we're here for the promise of creativity. We know that as designers and as makers of the web, we need to showcase creativity, but we also need to showcase courage, the courage that we need and the courage that you all show in continuing past our first, second, and third iterations. In seeing past the failed efforts in order to create a wonderful solution, we've all been there. We've all created multiple versions of the same thing in order to create something at the end that is something that we're proud of, right? And we're here because of all the beautiful abilities that you have to fulfill that promise to yourself. As I mentioned, we're here for creativity as well. The promise that you're going to see the problem through to the end. Now, I want to talk about just that, and that is creativity, because I believe that we can make our future, our near future after this pandemic is over, our most creative period yet. And, we're here because even though you know how scary it is to enter a design problem, not knowing what solution you're going to end up in, you take that leap of lightness. You suspend your disbelief, very similar to this image right here. And if we recall, this is just what you did when you were all kids. When we were kids, we enabled and motivated ourselves with dreams of the impossible. That is how we made sense of the world. And I would like to begin by dispelling some rumors about this topic. Play is not childish. And play, on the other hand, allows us to make sense of the world around us. Play sends us to a moment of time where anything is possible. And the most important thing about it as well is that play also has the unique quality of being human. And all the qualities that I just mentioned is exactly what we need in a time such as the time that we are living in right now. Play also allows us to make sense of many complex feelings. A great example of this is the 9/11 Museum in New York. So after the attack of September 11th, there has been a museum being erected in the place where World Trade Center once stand. And this, inside of this museum, you can see this art installation. This is an art installation by artist Spencer Finch titled Trying to Remember the Color of the Sky on That September Morning. Now, the installation is the focal point for this museum. It's called Memorial Hall here. And the area between is the two main exhibitions. There's a huge exhibition on the left, one on the right, and in the middle is this massive art piece. Every one of those 2,983 squares are their own shade of blue, one for each of the victims that perished in the attack of September 11th. Our own perception of the color blue might not be the same of that as that of another person, but just like our perception of color, our memories can share a common point of reference. Now, what Spencer's doing here is he's playing. This is play. It's plain and simple. It's beautiful. It's innocent. It's joyful. This is play at the literal heart of immense crisis and despair. Now, play indeed can be human, and it can also be deeply moving as well. Play can also allow us to subvert the status quo, to move away from it or challenge the status quo. Among many examples of the latter lies this piece of art. This is the painting called The Daddies by a Canadian artist. His name is Kent Monkman. Now, Monkman used a very well-known painting here in Canada. It's called Fathers of Confederation. And what he did is there's one stark difference: a naked Indigenous man in stiletto heels gesturing to the crowd right in front of him. Now, Monkman here used a playful and jarring juxtaposition to communicate the subversion of queer and Indigenous identity. So here, once again, we're seeing how, even though play is being used to subvert and challenge the status quo, it's a tool to use as well to indicate that we are human after all. Now, the reason why these two examples are so important is because these issues are not childish. These issues are complex. The museum piece the art piece in the 9/11 museum is extremely complex. The Daddies, the art piece that I just showed you, just as well. These issues are complex, yet both artists have chosen to use play as a tactic to make sense of tragic and complex issues facing our society today. And play doesn't have to solve complex issues all the time, of course. Play can also be used to offer that lasting bit of delight. Let's take a look at Great Jones. Great Jones is a company that makes pots and pans. And I really do believe that Pentagram, the design agency behind this brand identity that you see on the screen, used play in their creative process. They must have. Take a look at some, this is the website. Everything here it's lovely. It's playful. I invite you to visit their website. They have beautiful hover states that show a playful depiction of what sorts of meals you can prepare with these pots and pans. It is beautiful and selfless play. Now that we've taken a look at how impactful play can be, let's take a look at how to define it, and let's see how we can use it as well. Most importantly, let's begin to see how kids can use play. Donald Winnicott, he's an English pediatrician and child psychologist. He said the following. He said, without hallucinating, the child puts out a sample of dream potential and lives with the sample in a chosen setting of fragments from personal realities. So this is what they're doing when they're playing. They're pretty much hallucinating when they're playing. They're making up things in their mind. They're envisioning things right in front of them, dragons or spiders or whatever that the case might be. Now, I don't know about you, but this to me sounds completely badass. It's amazing. In other words, what Winnicott is saying is that when a child is engaged in play, they take material from their inner reality or their dream world, we can call it, and they place it directly on top of external reality, which is the world that we see today. That's what kids do when they play. So it can look like this. Play becomes then the intersection of dream and reality. And in that Venn diagram, in that intersection, that is when creativity is born. And that is when innovation can wield us forward, especially at a time like this. However, here's the risk. As adults, over time, instead of being attracted and exploring new and exciting environments that can allow us to increase our play, we begin to hone in only on the things that we know and the things that are relevant to us. That narrows our field of vision. And over time, it makes us close-minded, closing the door on this dream world. This leads to us feeling a lot more like this as adults. And as we see, even here, our external reality, it becomes misshaped because of the absence of dreams, the absence of that dream reality that we spoke about just a few seconds ago. And as adults, it's really interesting because we train ourselves to be systems that exploit rather than being systems that explore. A system that exploits uses everything at its disposal. It just pays attention to the things that are most relevant to its own goals. A system that explores, however, goes out and finds all kinds of information that might be relevant. This will become a common theme during our time today, and kids do this to perfection. They are the best example of a system that explores instead of being a system that exploits. Now, I'm afraid that most of us have become really efficient exploiting systems. We're not really good at exploring anymore. Of course, there's a few breaks of the rule here, but we know what to look for as adults, and we need to become efficient. We become efficient in our jobs. We become efficient in the way that we, have a daily routine, perhaps a weekly routine, and it's day in, day out, where we become very efficient as adults. However, efficiency can also breed tunnel vision. While there is nothing wrong with efficiency, and we need to have it, of course, to some extent, the biggest side effect is tunnel vision, which is an aversion to seeing things in a new way. It's easy to be in this loop, and we're caught between the now and the then. You know, we don't look up anymore. They need to be connected. Keeps our head down. It's the most logical choice to do as adults. We exploit the need to be connected in this field. And so, days go by looking nowhere but down, looking nowhere but, at our phones, seeking nothing because we don't need anything if we are a system that exploits. Something happens, though. If this has happened to you, you most likely feel something. Our work begins to suffer. It's as if we can harness the beauty of the world and transfer that into pixels. This is never easy to begin with. Design is never easy to begin with, but it becomes an even larger than life task. Now, I remember when I was young and inspiration came much easier. I used to marvel at the mundane, the very common things around me, like a box, for example, the way that a box's flaps closed in such a way to provide a secure latch, or for example, a loose faucet. I was amazed how it could only release one drop at a time, a faucet, just one. Unbelievable. So as kids, we bring this sense of innocence and wonder to everything around us. Mundane things like these gave me fuel to imagine a world and think in the most imaginative ways possible. Now, it is quite a curious thing, the fact that the most common things around us, the mundane, gives us the most fuel for creativity. It's true, though. Nowadays, we seek to be saturated with Netflix, video games, Snapchat, Instagram. And you know what? In a time like this, it might be okay. It might be the way that we can cope, and it might be a way that we can entertain ourselves. Now, the only ask that I have is that for us not to think that this is the answer to imagination. These Netflix, video games, Snapchat are not the answer to imagination. What we're doing here is we are impeding, we're stopping the dream world from entering into our minds. We are satiating, we're satisfying our need to explore by taking a look at a couple of YouTube videos. When I was younger, I dreaded being bored. That's the thing that I hated the most. And I still do hate to be bored. So what I used to do as a kid is I used to focus on faces like my grandfather's, or I used to focus on postures like that of my grandmother as she would cook us breakfast. I remember being young and in love with the world around me. And that allowed me to, remember committing things to memory. I would love memorizing things, memorizing scenes, not just like numbers, but memorizing the way that things looked at a certain period of time. Snapchat right now completely removes that ability for us. Now, remember, as a kid, remembering, mimicking, and marveling helped me architect my own reality. And today, as I just mentioned, we rely on systems that exploit to help us remember. We've begun to lose that essential aspect of our survival, and that is memory itself. This is memories, a brain-like feature in Snapchat, where in order to be shelved away, forgotten, until this system that exploits reminds you, hey, a year ago, you did this. 2 years ago, you did this. Now, these are the types of systems that, although some ways beneficial because it allows you to relive an experience, it also is a system that avoids you becoming a system of exploration. These are the types of systems that we need to avoid, because without memories, imagination and play cannot survive. Memory is closely linked to imagination and play. Now, when was the last time we used memory as a tool for a creative process? We know we've used many things. We've run workshops, perhaps you've created design sprints, but when was the last time you used memory as a tool for an exercise? Perhaps this question is harder to answer, but this next one is easier. When was the last time you did something for the sake of play? Just play. That can open up the room if you are, for example, facilitating a group of designers and multi-disciplinary people. That can open up the room for a bunch of creativity and imagination. Now, this person, Wendy Chien, decided to do something crazy during a sabbatical year away from the tech industry. She had just left Google, and Wendy was looking for the next big project, something that would elevate her craft, a place where she could find unstoppable creativity. So while she did this, she left Google, and in her time off, she decided to take a couple of months off work. She started playing in her spare time. She started creating a 365-day project, creating one unique knot every year. And the knot is like one that you see right here on the screen. At first, she exploited as many books as she could. She devoured knowledge on as many books as she could find on the techniques of creating these types of knots. Before long, however, she had become a system of beautiful exploration. Creativity was born out of this project. This playful act, where Wendy began mimicking and marveling the world around her, very similar to what we do when we're kids, we mimic the world around us, soon turned into a place where she was no longer mimicking, but she was inventing, she was defining, and she was forming the world around her. Now, out of these knots came the future for Wendy. She created these beautiful, she continues to create these beautiful pieces of art that sit in offices around the world. This one sits in California. It's called Circuit Board. It's from last year. This one sits in the Protégé offices. It's called Linescape. This one's coming up. It's beautiful. It's called Rope Tree Installation. And this is in a restaurant. Look, it's just wonderful. And, you know, she continues to create beautiful, beautiful artifacts. And to think that this whole thing started by her just thinking to herself, I'm going to learn how to create a knot, a unique knot every day of the year. And by mimicking, she began inventing her own reality. It's quite clear that Wendy used what I like to call the two-year-old mindset to help her create all of this beautiful art. The two-year-old mindset is pretty simple. You simply ask to yourself, why this, why that? If anyone has a two-year-old at home, you'll know what I mean. Every 2 to 4-year-old is asking, why this, why that? Well, this is exactly the type of energy that we need to bring to our work and to the work of the future as well. We need to establish and challenge the status quo, but we need to do it with play, because play is the only human element that will be able to unite people together in a time such as a pandemic. Now, remember one thing, the how, asking that and answering the how enables a design, but asking and answering the why, it motivates a design forward. And we need that in our field more than ever. We need that to find some type of North Star at times where there's absolutely nothing guiding us. And after this period is over, we might be in a period of just not doubt, but like, what's next? We might not know what the North Star is, but asking why, and you've probably heard root cause analysis, asking the five whys, you know, when you're task with a very challenging problem, you ask yourself why five times to get to the root level of what this design is really asking for. We need to find that North Star, and we can do that by creating and by adopting, rather, a two-year-old mindset. Answering the why can guide us. And, you know, who knew that two-year-olds were so groundbreaking? Pablo Picasso says that every child is an artist. The problem is how to remain an artist once they grow up. And he's right. He's absolutely right. The pressures of society pushes us to disconnect ourselves from each other and any playful opportunity. Now, I'll be the first one to tell you that there have been periods in my life where I've lost touch with this dream world. I've lost touch with my artistry, and every single person in this live stream has the capacity to be an artist, whether you're a designer or not. Every person in this room has already been an artist when they were kids. Many cognitive abilities and effective processes occur in pretend play. In short, engaging in pretend play fosters a development in creativity. Pretend play is like any musical, any concert, any performance, any playoff game that you've ever been to. You're witnessing art when you're seeing a person engage in pretend play, which is usually a child. When children engage in pretend play, we discover how they generate stories and ideas over a period of time. We can also observe their abilities to organize narratives. We can measure the amount of fantasy and make-believe in which they engage, their ability to symbolize or transform objects, for example, a box into a castle, and the skill that they have at recombining objects, images, and story events all in one go. So much so that the narrative becomes fluid, even though the context might not be very realistic, like the lava, like the floor turning into lava or something like that. Now, creativity is not concerned with what is right or what is wrong. And play allows people to manipulate objects, mental images, and mental models to compose stories. That is exactly what we need to do. We need to adopt a storytelling methodology to design if we want to create something brand new out of this period. Play allows us to, allows an individual rather, to explore an imaginary cave, to welcome the unknown, to rehearse a tough scenario, to deal with grief, loss, and to recall a memory hidden with embedded emotions. Now, more importantly, play allows us to find a framework for our creativity. And the framework is simple. I've actually already mentioned it. It's one we've known all of our lives. That framework that we need to adopt is storytelling. Storytelling is a practice as old as time. It is a tradition embedded into us through the last tens of thousands of years. This is a practice that enables us to create more significant knowledge by learning the skill of growing deeper understandings. This is what kids do. They constantly frame and reframe experiences into stories, and we can too. There's a wonderful book out there called The Hero with a Thousand Faces. I really recommend you read this. In this book, Campbell asserts that regardless of the story, our collective narrative follows the same process. So from Beowulf and Grendel to Harry Potter, the journey the hero creates is exactly the same. Lucky for us, we can actually use the exact same framework to employ the use of narrative design. Now, narrative design is a wonderful framework, and it is something that you can take away and apply immediately. For any design sprint, for any collaboration that you have in the future, you can apply the hero's journey, this narrative design, which I'll showcase right now, to frame your goals and expectations for the day. Most importantly, you can use this exercise to pave a way for play. This is what it looks like. This is what a hero's journey looks like. And what you usually do is you sit in a room and you can actually do this digitally or not, remotely or not. You pretty much just draw, or you can just show this image right here. And this really speaks to the fact that as a hero, we start in ordinary life. You can actually see right at the top, there's a person that says ordinary life. This is us. This is a hero. And there's a call to adventure. And this call to adventure, we also meet a helper or a mentor. And this allows us to pass the threshold from the known world into the unknown world. We have problems and pitfalls in this unknown world. And right at the bottom, we have the pit. The pit is where any story feels like that hero will not survive. The hero will die. But something happens. The hero gains new powers, new powers through either the help of research, through the help of their mentor and their helper. Those new powers allow them to move outside of the unknown world and into the known world. And they return to the world with gifts. This is the way that I like to frame every design sprint that I go through. With this exercise, you are inadvertently using future thinking. You're giving your participants a view of the adventure. It will be hard. It will be challenging, but we will surface victorious with gifts to bring back to the world. Now, how beautiful is that? How playful is that as well? I highly recommend for you to try this. All it takes is 5 minutes to frame this, your sprint or your workshop into a story. It takes 5 minutes, but you're paving the way for playful ideas to occur. Now, Hero's Journey is the first of many collaborative exercises that you can facilitate to enable play and creativity and creative thinking. Now, in design, I strongly feel that we need to have collaboration in order to achieve playful and transformative ideas. Why do we need this? Well, we need this so that we can copy jazz musicians. Jazz music is all about improvisation. Whether good or bad, musicians do not care. They allow themselves to suspend their disbelief. And with music, they are answering the yes and instead of yes but. And UX, answering the yes and, is a lot more productive when you have playful minds in the room thinking as wildly as possible. Creativity researchers, beginning with Joy Paul Guilford, this person right here in 1950, identified an important correlation between storytelling and play. At the spotlight is divergent thinking. Divergent thinking gives individuals an incredible subset of superpowers, broad associative skills, insight, cognitive possibilities. Children need this as much as we need it as adults. And most importantly, divergent thinking involves the ability to generate a variety of ideas. Now, it's no surprise to anyone in this room that divergent thinking is one of the most important skills we need in our field. Our careers are defined by how divergent we can be. The latter, coupled with a strong sense of what the business needs can be, allow us to innovate forward. And what is interesting about play is that it not only fosters divergent thinking, play also produces themes in fantasy and memory, emotion, affection, experience of joy, and creative expression. And that is exactly what we need to do today. Thank you so much for being here with me today. I'm going to let the moderator take over. Thank you.
Thank you, Ricardo. Actually, at the beginning of this year, we created a UX Trends report, and one of the titles in this report is "The Role of Designer is Changing." Actually, the designer is becoming more storyteller and facilitator during a design process, and your presentation is a really good example how to a designer become a good storyteller or become a playful designer. Actually, kids are learning how to code, and the adults are learning design thinking. What do you think?
Absolutely. I think kids learning how to code is one great way of making sure that the creativity that they have is harnessed into the digital world. I would, however, whenever I see kids code, I often think about, if they're spending 3 hours coding, they need to be spending 6 hours playing, you know, because the play is what's going to give them enough creativity to be able to code something brand new, something that we've never seen, something innovative.
Okay. And another question comes from our colleagues. Can we design some playful experiences during some serious stuff, about some serious stuff like pandemic, or about some serious or boring stuff like financial interfaces or financial process?
Yeah, that's actually a really great question. I think that you can. It's all about framing the context of play in the most respectful ways possible. So in the case of a pandemic, and if I were to lead a workshop, which I led one a couple of weeks ago, I'm not going to start with "let's play," you know. Rather, I'm going to start with, we need some broad ideas. We need to generate as many ideas as possible in order to serve these people. Let's use some techniques that we've learned that will allow us to broaden our mindset And then I usually show Hero's Journey. I show another one is 685. You might have heard of it as a Crazy Eights. You take a piece of paper, you create eight boxes, and then you allow people to create eight unique ideas in each box. That is another type of play. Sometimes you don't even need to say the word play. If you facilitate a workshop and you have these activities that you know are going to bring out divergence, that you know are going to bring out brand new dream reality or new ideas, that's all you need to do. You don't need to really frame it as playtime.
The final question is about gamification. Do you think gamification in a process is a good example of play, or are we all bored about that kind of gamification?
Yeah.
Like ads, leaderboards, and other stuff.
Absolutely. I do not think that gamification is the best example of play. That person is right. I think that gamification has been used a lot. Gamification is not play. Gamification is simply enticing someone to continue doing the same thing again and again and again, and rewarding them for that. But play is not about reward. Play is about imagining new worlds around you. So I think that gamification has given play a bad reputation for that reason.
Mm-hmm. And we have some questions from participants. Evren asked, have you ever applied Hero's Journey in a remote session?
Yes, a week ago. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. And all it takes is showcasing that screen. That's it. And you, of course, talking about it a few minutes about what we're going to experience, how we're going to have a call to adventure, how it's going to feel like. It's going to feel hard, in the next day or so. But rest assured, we will come back, and we will come back bearing new gifts to the world. But yes, absolutely. It's actually my preferred method remotely now.
And there is a book named Gamestorming. There are lots of techniques for using on brainstorming sessions and gamifying the brainstorming sessions.
Absolutely, yeah.
Advise our participants.
Yeah, absolutely. I would definitely recommend the book. The Hero's Journey is in that book, Gamestorming. 685 is another one, which Crazy Eights, the same thing, is also in that book. There's a bunch of games for opening, games for closing, games for collaboration, games for tactical, for example, creating roadmaps. There's a bunch of games for that. And that is exactly the book that, if you're interested in applying game playful techniques, that is the book that you should definitely get.
Okay. Thank you, Ricardo. Thank you for participating in UX Alive.
Thank you so much. Yes.
Next year we will be in Istanbul, maybe other years.
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me.
Have a nice day.